welcome or welcome back to my channel. My name is Liv, and this week we are going to be doing my Summerween reading vlog. For those of you who don't know, Summerween is a week-long readathon that is hosted by Gabby from Gabby Reads every July, and it is just bringing the feeling of spooky Halloween October time into the summer, which, like, I just love because I want it to be spooky October time all of the time. Okay, it is currently 11:36 p.m. on July 4th. So if you can hear the fireworks, I do apologize. I mostly apologize, though, to the bean because this is the first time we have lived. Well, not me, but it's the first time he's lived in a state where, like, residents can legally purchase fireworks and set them off as they darn well please. He was really bugging. He used to be scared of everything, though, and I got him from the rescue. So this is the first time in a long time he's been freaked out, so we'll take it. But also insert here a photo of him in my headphones, which I thought he was gonna hate, but I didn't know what to do. And he looked at me like, you know those videos of, like, when you put glasses on a baby for the first time? That was how he looked at me. So sweet, so cute. But like I said, we are close to the start of Summerween, and I want to start my reading off tonight. Okay, the fireworks are so bad. Like, I'm just gonna talk through them. I am so sorry if you have, like, sensory issues. I will put here the time to jump to just get out of this portion. I'm just gonna quickly talk about the books that I have planned for this week, since I also currently, right now, sitting on my desk, have my Summerween TBR. It is ready to be published to my YouTube, and I'm gonna do that exactly at midnight, and then we're gonna start reading one of these books. Moving through the prompts, we have Read a Book in the Dark, which you can use, like, any prompt for. We have Read a Thriller or Horror. We have Read a Book with a Night Sky on the cover. We have Read a Book with 5 words in the title. And we have Read a Book that is set in the summer. Let's first talk about the book that I didn't put in my Summerween TBR because I hadn't started it yet and didn't realize I was going to be doing that. That's Never Whistle at Night, an Indigenous Dark Anthology that is edited by Shane Hawk and Theodore C. Van Alst Jr. First of all, like, I just love this cover. Moving into this month, I was like, I just want to try to read one short story collection. We're starting on the first. I read one short story a day because I be collecting anthologies and short story collections and never ever picking them up. So I didn't put this in my TBR, but I think this is what I'm gonna use for Read a Book at Night. I have currently coming a book light to clip on to, like, the headboard of my bed so I can read this. Hopefully I can just, like, turn it down to the dimmest setting so it can be as dark as possible. So maybe I'll read a book in the dark every night. I also just realized that maybe I've been saying Read a Book at Night instead of Read a Book in the Dark. What is Read a Book in the Dark if that's what I was saying? This has been really good so far. I am 83 pages in, and today is the 4th, so I should have only read 4, but the 4th one was only, like, 8 pages long, so I read 2 today. But I'm really enjoying this so far, and I haven't given out, like, below a 3.5, I don't think. For Read a Horror or a Thriller, I have Fantastic Land by Mike Bakovin. One, I was supposed to read this last month, and two, the first person I ever saw talk about this was Gabby, so I feel like that just fits great. When I hold it up, you can see how red I am, but let's not talk about it. For a book with 5 words in the title, I have A Devil Comes to Town by Paula Manzarig. Like I said, we're not doing synopses because I'm gonna talk about all these in this vlog, or you can go watch my TBR if you'd like. And then I have Organ Meats by Haiming Chang. Wow, this really, who is she? This is my book for a Read a Book that is set in the summer. And Read a Book with a Night Sky is also the book we are going to kick this vlog off with. And that is Middle of the Night by Riley Sager. And I will tell you about this one because this is what we are starting this vlog off with. We are following Ethan, who, when Ethan is 13, he and his BFF Billy, they have a sleepover in his backyard, and in the morning Billy is gone. And I think this is taking place, like, 10 or 15 years later. Ethan, for some reason, is gone back home, and while he's back home, someone who looks suspiciously like Billy, or I guess, like, what Billy would look like now, unless it looks like the child version of Billy, I don't know, I'm assuming it would look like adult Billy, people are kind of seeing him, and we're gonna figure it out. We're gonna figure it out together. This book is 365 pages long, and in my TBR, I originally said that I was gonna read this last because it is the longest book on this TBR. But now that I've thought about it, I think, like, the first beginning days of a readathon, like, I am so motivated and I'm getting every inch of reading in that I can in my life. So I'm actually gonna put this one first. Okay, realistically, I don't know how much of this I am gonna get done after midnight tonight. I would like to get the first few chapters out of the way. And I've read Riley Sager a couple times before. I think the chapters are shorter, so that will be helpful. Oh yeah, chapter 2 starts on like page 9. So I'm excited to see what I think about this one. It is now 11:45. I have 15 minutes. I'm gonna go download the audiobook for this and charge up my phone as much as possible. So right at midnight, we can post the TBR and we can start reading. I will update you tonight, probably just on how far I get into it, because I don't think I'll get that far for like a big update. And then tomorrow, once I get around like the 100 page mark, we will talk again. Exactly 41 pages into middle of the night. Really don't have much to say right now because we're still in the beginning. We're mostly following Ethan while he has just moved back into his parents' house, and he's always having this reoccurring dream of he can like hear the tent being slashed open even though he doesn't remember, and he knows he slept through the night. And it's kind of him reliving the moment, thinking about it and obsessing over it, and like the years of insomnia that have followed because he's so scared to sleep now. But it's mostly just been backstory so far, so I don't have a ton to say. We are switching in between. It's doing like 2 chapters and then we'll go back in time to when Billy goes missing. So we start in like July 16th of 1994, and then the next one is 15th. So it's the day before Billy goes missing. And there's twice now that he has sensed Billy's presence almost. The first, like, we open with he wakes up in the middle of the night, and the AC just turned on and the remote is so far away. Essentially, he just wakes up in the middle of the night and all of the like automatic lights in the garages in the neighborhood are going off, but nothing's out there that he can see. So he goes down when it's supposed to be his garage and he sees nothing. But then he's standing out there and he feels like he senses a presence, and he feels like it's Billy, like it's a presence he hasn't sensed in 30 years. And then the next morning, the lawn people come to mow their lawn because it's a bougie suburban neighborhood. The guy like comes and knocks on the door and is like, will you like make sure your kids, he doesn't have any kids, will you make sure your kids like don't leave their toys in the yard? And there's a baseball in the yard, which was how Billy used to tell Ethan he wanted to like hang out and play. He would throw a baseball over like the hedges and between their lawns. So I have a lot of questions and I have zero theories, because both of the twists that I've read in like Riley Sager books, like I know it's not gonna be normal. Like I know it's not gonna be someone in the neighborhood just like kidnapped this kid, and it's not gonna be just like a generic like Criminal Minds episode answer, but I have no idea what the answer is gonna be. I am gonna go to bed shortly. I'm probably gonna watch like 1 or 2, maybe just like 1 YouTube video, or wrap up something shorter, and then I'm gonna go to bed. I work from 5 p.m. to 1 a.m. tomorrow, so I'm gonna try to be in bed by 1:30 and then be up by like 9:30 to read some more. I will update you probably once I get a little just past the 100 page mark, because I guess I had a little more to say than I thought that I would, but I'm hoping to bang out like at least at minimum 150 pages of this tomorrow, but I want to hit more. So I really just kind of want to wake up, have breakfast, shower, basically be ready except for getting dressed for work, and then read for the rest of the day. So hopefully that works out for me, but I've had a lot of early mornings this week, so if 9:30 comes around and I want to hit snooze, I'm giving myself that permission. I'm allowing it, especially since my work closes at 1, so I'll be home at like 2 a.m. I will see you soon with another update for middle of the night. Morning, everyone, or good afternoon. It's a little bit past noon, but I have been spending my morning reading, and I am now 127 pages in
2.
Middle of the Night by Riley Sager. I don't think I really have much more to tell you than I did last night, like, plot-wise. There's been, like, a little bit of a new development in Billy's case, and Ethan has kind of been, like, talking to former friends, and he's probably gonna start playing detective. This is all, like, in the synopsis. It's interesting to try to figure out how I'm feeling about this right now, because it's Riley Sager, so I know it's not gonna be just, like, a cookie-cutter ghost story or a cookie-cutter crime story. Like, there's gonna be some sort of twist. But, like, right now, I am intrigued to see what he's gonna do with this book, while also simultaneously just being so bored with what I'm reading. Because at the moment, like, we're kind of just, like, not a lot is happening, and it's very slow. And there are times where I like a slow burn, where it's building a lot of tension, and there's a lot of unease in the pages. Or if the writing is so, like, intricately beautiful, like, those are times I really like slow burns, but this isn't doing any of that for me. So, I am still intrigued to see where it's gonna go, but for me, like, a horror thriller, if you're not building that tension with me, like, it's not gonna be a 5-star. So I don't think that that is where we're headed, unless there's, like, some sort of crazy twist, or it, like, starts to pick up in the next 50 pages. Because we don't, like, it's just, we're just kind of watching this man go through his daily life, and he just keeps thinking the same things that he's been thinking since the beginning. And we're just, like, the flashback scenes that are set in 1994, they're only, like, 2 pages long. So you're just following either Ethan or Billy or some of the parents, and it's trying to build some mystery around them, and it is doing that a little, but, like, I know it's gonna get stressed out the whole book, and it's not like I'm, like, dying to turn the page to get to the next 1994 part. So we'll see what happens in the next, like, 100 or so pages, if it picks up at all. I am gonna go make myself some lunch and then probably continue reading some more of this. I have really not looked up any reviews for this. I don't want to know what anyone's thinking or saying. I'm just gonna read it at face value, decide what I think, and then I'll go see what everyone is saying. I feel like Riley Sager, he's always, it's a mixed bag. People either really love it or really hate it, and it usually always depends on what the twist is. We'll see. Hopefully I can get, like, another 100 pages done before I have to get ready for work. That would be nice, because I'm definitely not gonna be reading after work, so I just kinda wanna get through as much as possible today. I also have just, like, these 2 tabs where I've decided I'm just gonna write my theories as they come up, and I know they're gonna be wrong. Like, he has to do something else, because both of these are just very easy endings, and they wouldn't even be a twist, so it has to be something else, but I do kind of just, like, want to see the progression of what I think is gonna happen. I'm gonna go eat, and then I will update you once I'm further along into this. Hey, we are updating you now because I set up my tripod and everything and was about to hit record, and my roommates got home. I am on my way to work, so we're gonna make this pretty quick. I just stopped for a smoothie. I am now 233 pages in to Middle of the Night by Riley Sager. I am enjoying it a bit more. It just took until, like, the 170-ish page mark for this man to really start thinking about or trying to investigate anything. And I'm currently more interested in the past timeline than the future one. I think the future one is maybe, or the present day one is getting there, but right now it's definitely the past one that's really holding my attention more. I am not done reading for the day. I am gonna be at work until at least anywhere between midnight and 2 a.m. probably, unless by some miracle I get out early. And I know last night I started my page count for today at midnight, but moving forward my page count each day is gonna end, like, when I go to bed. And I still need to read my short story from Never Whistle at Night, which I'm gonna do in the dark. I forgot to check out my cart on Amazon, so I'm definitely gonna be reading just with the flashlight on my phone tonight. That's fine. It's more nostalgic and more reminiscent. I have put in my third theory, and this third theory kind of ties a little bit of my first two together in a way, and it actually seems like something that could possibly be going on, but also it's Riley Sager, so it could just be a gigantic red herring. Like I said earlier, the past ones follow anywhere from Billy to Ethan to some of their friends to the parents in the past timelines, but I really enjoy Billy's just because he reminds me of me as a child. He's a little weird. He's into the supernatural. He's just a goofy little guy. So
I'm really enjoying those parts. And I kind of, I'm getting a bit more excited. Like, now that I can't be reading it, I'm like, maybe I'm enjoying this more than I thought I was gonna be. But I'm gonna go run and get my smoothie and head to work. I will see you probably at like 2 a.m. with an update. And hopefully I can finish this tomorrow morning before I have to go to a grad party. So we will see. But I am aiming. That's the goal. That's the goal. That's what we're aiming for. We're gonna try to do it. Okay, I'm done talking. I'm so warm.
All right, guys. Happy day two of Summerween. I did in fact read last night, but I didn't get home until like 2:30 a.m. and I really just couldn't be bothered to set up the camera or chit or chat or any of it. I was exhausted. I did read my one story in Never Whistle at Night, and I did read it in the dark by my phone light. But my book light is coming today, so I'll be able to set that up tonight. But the story I read yesterday was Hunger by Phoenix Boudreau. In Hunger, we're following a supernatural creature who has been on these lands for as long as the indigenous people and is always hunting them. But ever since the other people arrive, its hunger is never quite satiated and it always wants more. It's very much a fun, supernatural, spooky one, but it's also about colonization, and I gave that one a 4-star. And then after that, I did just read a little more of Middle of the Night. I think I probably read like 30 more pages last night, and I didn't have much more to say other than what I had already said, so I also didn't feel the need to set up the camera. But yesterday's page count ended at like 280 pages, which for having to work and for having to work so long, that's good, and we'll take it. But then this morning, I immediately got up and finished Middle of the Night, and by this morning, I mean almost this afternoon, because I didn't get to bed until almost 5 a.m. I'm gonna give this a 3.5, I think. Like, I just, in good conscience, we can't bump it up to a 4, okay? I can't do it, because for the first like almost 200 pages, I was just a little bored. Also, there's one twist that comes where like I didn't even write a sticky note because it seemed like a very obvious thing to me in the beginning of the pages. So I was like, well, obviously it's not gonna be that. And it was, but it was one of the teeny tiny minor twists, and it wasn't like the solution to the entire story, but it was kind of a bigger solution, and it just seemed very obvious to me from the beginning. That being said, the main culprit was not someone I guessed. Also, in the last like 50 or 60 pages of this, I did have a little moment. I cried a little. That being said, it's very, very easy for me to cry while reading books, so it probably not the same effect for everybody else. Next, I'm hopping into Fantastic Land by Mike Bakovin. One, I can't wait to get to this book, and two, this is my Gabby book. This is my book that I heard about through Gabby for the first time, so I thought it would be fitting for Summerween. This book, we are following an amusement park in Florida in like the 70s, I think. I don't love to read synopses, so we're not going to. From what I know, a hurricane comes through and it just ravages Florida, and everyone is now trapped at this amusement park who's there that day, and they're just like not on the high priority list of people who need to be saved and rescued. So they're trapped there for like 5 weeks or something ridiculous. And I think it's gonna be like the horrors of what humans can do to each other in a situation like this. Like, I think it might be a little Purge-esque. I haven't watched any of the Purges yet. I want to, but like, I think it's gonna be kind of that vibe. And there's a giant glare, so we're just gonna take these off. And actually, Lauren from Happy Haunts Library just commented on my TBR video, because again, I was like, this is what I know, and I'm not a synopsis girly. But she reminded me that this book is told like all through interviews after the fact of being rescued, which is actually, I'm pretty sure, a big reason that I was initially intrigued in this one, because it's a bit of kind of like multimedia-esque. So I really cannot wait to start this one. I just don't know if I'm gonna have time today, because I still have this grad party to go to, but it's also doubling as like a late 4th of July party, so it's gonna go later, and there's gonna be fireworks, and then I open at work tomorrow, so I'm probably gonna leave early, so maybe I can get the first few chapters done tonight. I'm just like bopping around, sorry. I just can't start it before I leave, because I really desperately need to film my June wrap-up, because I don't know the next time I'm gonna be home alone and be able to film during the day. So I have all of my notes ready. I just need my hair to dry so I can scrunch out the mousse, and then I have to get my butt to this party because I'm already a little late. But I will update you once I get a little into Fantastic Land. It might not be tonight because I might only read the first couple chapters, but I'll definitely update you tomorrow once I get into the thick of it. I have to put in my spooky earrings. I forgot. That's sad. I was gonna wear my pumpkins today. I guess I'll wear them tomorrow. I hope you all are having an amazing Summerween so far, because I sure am. I've got sprints up on the screen, even though I can't really partake in the reading. I want to be part, you know? I want to feel included. So I've got them up. All right, I will update you probably tomorrow with some thoughts on Fantastic Land. I read just genuinely nothing when I got home from this grad party. One, we got home really late, and two, I am pooped. But it's up here, my reading light. I have it set up. I haven't turned it on yet, but the little control is glowing, so I figured that I would test it for the first time in the dark so I can read in the dark, which I've already done, but I don't have videographic evidence. I have Never Whistle at Night. That was backwards. And I have actually the audiobook along with this, because as well as every short story obviously being written by an different Indigenous author, everyone is read by a different Indigenous author. So we're just gonna sit down and do that. Please ignore like my over my nice comforter blankies. These are simply because no matter how much I brush Navy, he will not stop shedding, and it is so much easier to just wash these every 2 days than washing the whole comforter because he is everywhere. Like, I vacuumed in here not even 4 days ago, and like there's a whole new Navy growing on the ground, so I have to do that again. But we are gonna shut off the lights and we're gonna read my next short story, which is called Tick Tock, but tick like a clock and then talk like talking. And I wonder if it's gonna have anything to do with social media. Are you fucking kidding me? This battery's gonna die. Let's turn out the lights and turn on this. I hope there is plus and minus, so I hope it gets really, really dim so like it can be reading in the dark, but it is 12:56 in the morning. And like I was tired all day and the freaking sun went down and I'm awake, but like my brain is also like pooped. So let's do this. So update. It was called TikTok because it has to do with a tick. And I really don't mind bugs. I really don't. But fuck a tick. So many of these, like, on my little sticky note, like, I was wondering, one, where the horror of the story was gonna come in. It was the tick. And two, like, what, like, the theme of the story was gonna be. I was like, is it the things that drive us away from home and then bring us back? Is it loss or grief? And I really don't know if it was any of those things or what it was. Like, all of my little sticky notes, like, I have, like, actual notes. Like, good but predictable, elitist pricks, we love when white guys get what they deserve, enjoyed the Wendigo lore, and there was colonization. And then this one I just wrote 3 stars. Tick. I mean, obviously you saw in the clip, like, it gave me a visceral reaction, which usually doesn't happen, but what was the point, though? Like, is it about, no, I don't know. Okay. I'm too tired to try to decipher either, so let's just see how the day went for me. I had 96 pages left of middle of the night this morning when I finished that. This short story was 14 pages, and Fantastic Land I have read a whopping 7 pages of. So that puts my page count for the day at 117 pages. Obviously not the 280 that I did yesterday, but 100 is my page goal for days that I don't have work. So the fact that I got my wrap up filmed, I finished a book, and I did this whole party thing and was gone all day, we're gonna take it. That's good. We're gonna be done reading for the night. I can't do it. First, that one started off like slow, and I was like, oh damn. Like, this dark in here, and like a little like slow, nothing going on yet. I'm a bit sleepy. I am now no longer sleepy. The tick has awoken me. That's like the only thing that's ever come up in a horror story that I was like, absolutely fucking not, dude. Oh, fuck a tick. Like, I want to go take a shower now. No, that's like dramatic, but like, ugh. And like, if you've read that, then like you know what I'm talking about. I don't know what I'm doing. This is 1 a.m. Olivia for you. That being said, it's 1:18 and I am gonna go collect the doggo and go to bed. And I work actually at noon, so I really should be in bed. So I will read a little after work tomorrow and I will update you tomorrow night on how my Summerween is going. Good night, and don't forget to check for ticks. Happy day 4 of Summerween, everybody. I did not update you on day 3 because I did not read a single thing. I got home from work, I had a pounding migraine. I could not do it. So today, I just got home from work. It's 4:45. I'm going to finally actually jump into Fantastic Land and I will update you soon. Hello and happy day 5 of Summerween. Today, I have my skeletons in and I have made some good progress on the books. So let's chat. I also love how every day I'm like, happy day whatever of Summerween, as if this isn't gonna go up after, but I hope everyone had a great Summerween and is loving everything that they're reading as much as I am. So quickly first, just because this is gonna be the quicker one, let's talk about the story I read in Never Whistle at Night. Last night's story, the lizard finally reached the top of his cage and one day he is truly gonna figure out how to open it. The story I read last night is The Ones Who Killed Us by Brandon Hobson. This one also had a lot of themes of colonization, but instead of like modern day effects of colonization, this is set right after settlers come to America and it is a ghost revenge story. I enjoyed it. I think I only gave it 4 stars because there's no paragraphs. It's really just like blocks of text and I had to restart the audio for this one twice, but also yesterday, again, just like by the end of the day, pounding migraine. So yesterday I only read 77 pages, but this morning I have already read over 100. I've read about 120. So I'm further along in Fantastic Land than I thought I was gonna be. And I'm trying to think of the word that I want for this. Well, not for this, but like in my explanation, because I know there's a word, I just can't think of it. But it's like a character study if you're not studying a character. Like, this is a study in fear. And let me actually read the synopsis before we continue talking. Okay, so this book is just like fucking bananas bonkers and I can't look away. I can't stop reading. And I'm now stuck with just like this insane anger because I really only have like a little over an hour, like an hour and a half left in this audiobook at 2 speed, which I'm kind of adjusting depending on chapters, which if I'm correct, shout out to the 2 narrators of this book because there are only 2 narrators credited for this book, but they have such different voices for every interview that's conducted in the pages. Like, that's just stellar. If you're gonna read this, I highly recommend the audiobook as well. Okay, study in fear. And it is, because we're following these teenagers and young adults. Most of them are like just out of high school. They're coming home for summers to work here. And we're following them as they are cut off with all outside resources. Like, none of them are allowed to have phones on them while they're working. And they live in dormitories in this place as they work there over the summer, and they often leave their phones in the dormitories, and it's rained so much that to get to the dormitories is completely flooded and no one can get there. So no one has a way to get to their phone. There's no power. The radios aren't working. They have absolutely no idea what's going on in the outside world. And then at first people start accidentally dying. And after the first dead body, obviously there's going to be a spike in fear. We're kind of following all these teenagers as they're breaking off into sections, and it kind of starts with them going back to the parts of the park that they work in, because the whole vision for Fantastic Land was that it feels like it's 5 separate parks. So a lot of them go either where they know their friends are or back to their own place. And there are some groups who are taking it a little further than they should be. They're looting other people, there's violence, and obviously you're not gonna just sit back. People are gonna retaliate and they're gonna find ways to defend themselves. And it's like, I cannot look away. Like I said, I never even told you my problem. I have like an hour and a half left of this audiobook and I have like 45 minutes before I need to be skedaddling, skadooting out the door for work. And I know if I keep reading, I'm gonna be pissed where I leave off, but also I really want to keep reading. But I think I'm just gonna have to bite the bullet and finish it when I get home from work. I get off at 11, so I'll be home around midnight. So maybe I'll finish it in the dark. There's also some mysteries going on and some that have already been answered through interviews, but then there's probably like the most violent young adult in this, and there's someone that he keeps referencing, but we have no idea who this person is or if something has happened to them. So I'm assuming that in the next, I think I have less than 100 pages left, we're gonna find out. Yeah, I have 80, a little less than 80 pages left of this book. So I'm highly intrigued. I'm really loving it. I don't think I have a single complaint in anything I've read so far. Like, there's nothing that's annoying me. It is holding my attention. Like, I just want to keep devouring this. So I think we are on track for our first 5-star of Summerween if the ending doesn't terribly piss me off. I now have no idea what I want to do before I leave for work. I think I am definitely going to finish this tonight because this isn't, like, technically on my Summerween TBR. This is just something I've been using to fulfill the read at night. And so after this, I only have 2 books left. And one is hardly over 100 pages. If I keep looking, it's because the books are over there on the top of my bookshelf. One is like 240 pages and one is barely over 100. And while I haven't been that successful so far in reading as much as I wanted to, I am off on Wednesday and Thursday, the final 2 days of Summerween. So I think I can freaking do it. And I'm hoping that I can finish those 2 really quick so I can kind of just like maybe abandon my just reading 1 short story a day and read a bunch more of these. That is all for this update. I will maybe see you at like 1 a.m. when I finish Fantasticland, or if I am so freaking tired, I will update you tomorrow. But I guess for the next like 40 minutes, maybe I'll just go find some Summerween vlogs to watch. And like I already called myself out, you're not gonna see this till after, but I hope you all are having a fantastic day 5 of Summerween. What is up, everybody? It is technically 12:27 if you want to be exact. So it is technically day 6 of Summerween. But about an hour and a half ago, I did finish Fantasticland by Mike Bakovin. And I was correct. This is 5 stars. There's not much more to say other than what I said in my last update. Like, only had 80 pages left. And obviously, the style of the book didn't change. It's all told throughout these interviews of this man who's putting a book together on Fantasticland a year after everything has occurred. It just remained bonkers. It only got more bonkers. I would highly recommend this. The synopsis intrigues you at all. It was a really great time. And I listened to the end of the audiobook and they only cited the 2 narrators. So I do truly believe that just 2 people did all of this. Just the different voices and the different accents and the way they portrayed every single character was so great. So I would also really recommend the audiobook. This is like one of those ones where like, this is a 5-star. I don't like foresee it being in my top books of the year, but it is still a 5-star. I was looking, and this appears to be Mr. Bakovin here's first novel, his debut, but he has had 2 more that have come out since. I haven't looked into them at all, but I would be intrigued in reading something else by him. And I was also really intrigued by this because if you've been here at all this year, you know that I have been obsessed with the Indian Lake trilogy. And in the acknowledgments of the final book, Stephen Graham Jones like went on about how he loved this book. And I think that's really interesting because Stephen Graham Jones tried to kind of like incorporate some news interviews and things like that in the book. So like, I wonder if that's where that came from and that's where that was inspired from. So that was also just like interesting for me to pay attention to and think about why maybe this was prevalent to the Indian Lake trilogy enough to be in the acknowledgments. And then this doesn't have any acknowledgments. There's no about the author. There's nothing. I had to go look this man up. And then also I read my Never Whistle at Night story, which we talked about the name earlier. It was Snakes Are Born in the Dark by D.H. Trujillo. This one I gave 5 stars. This one was kind of all about ancestral respect and white people's lack thereof in respect for history that isn't really their own and doesn't like isn't prevalent to them. And I really enjoyed it. I thought it was written really well as well. And I liked the ending, which has been a little hard for me to say in some of these. There are a lot that have had potentials to be 5 stars, but then either like the ending didn't do enough for me or I wanted like a little more out of it. Like there's one where we're following these 2 boys in a foster home and I kind of just wanted more of the 2 boys before it ended. And then there's one following a mother who she has 2 children from different dads and one of them has enough Indian blood to be like on, like to get a check from the reservation from the casino and one doesn't, and the difference in that. And I wanted, let's just say I wanted more of a payoff in the end of that one because I obviously don't want to give anything away. These are very short stories, but I am really, really enjoying this so far. I don't think I've given anything, well, I definitely know I haven't given anything under a 3, and I think most everything has been like 3.5. half or above. The one I've liked the least so far is the Tick one that you all watched me read, and that's just like because I don't know if it went over my head, but like I don't know fully what the point of that one was or what the message was. It was gross, and like I do enjoy gross, and I obviously had a very visceral reaction, but like if you're doing something so short, like are you just trying to be gross, or is like I feel like I missed something. And it went over my head and I didn't know what the point was. That being said, that being the 45-second yawn that editing Olivia just cut out, I'm exhausted, and so I'm gonna go to bed. But tomorrow, I think I'm gonna immediately pick up A Devil Comes to Town, and I think I remember the prologue enough that I don't need to reread that, but I was, like, in the middle of chapter one, so I'll restart that, and the whole book itself is, like, under 100 pages, or, like, 105, so I should have less than 100 pages left, so I can hopefully get that done tomorrow and start Oregon Meets, but I'm also thinking, like, I didn't have any other books planned for Summerween, so maybe I can edit some of this video, or maybe I should, you know, like, edit the book haul that I filmed in the beginning of May and still haven't posted, and now I have plenty more books to haul, so. That being said, happy sleepy start to day 6 of Summerween, and I will see you tomorrow with some more bookish updates. Also, I forgot to tell you, but my page count was 219 for the day. So that's pretty good. We'll take it. But yeah, now I'm going to bed. Goodbye. First of all, I know the lighting in here is terrible. We're rolling with it. This afternoon, I picked up and finished A Devil Comes to Town by Paulo Morensig. This one is following a man who goes to like a psychoanalyst conference to see if he can find someone to publish for his uncle's publishing house. And he ends up meeting this priest who speaks at the conference and is talking about how the devil is just a man in his plain clothes. He finds the priest and the priest tells him this story about when he was younger and kind of just out of training in priesthood and was going somewhere as an interim priest. He met the devil in this town that was filled with writers, and the devil showed up as a publisher. I really loved the concept of this, but I don't know if I wanted it from a different character's point of view or a few other point of views in here, or if just like it's supposed to be a horror and really there was no tension. It was never that scary. You kind of just like knew where the story was going. And this one is translated from Italian, which I am trying to read more translated books, so that ticks that off. I just think I wanted a little more out of it. Once I finished that, I watched some Summerween vlogs, and then I picked up Oregon Meets. This book, we're following two girls who decide to become dogs together, and they both tie a piece of red thread around their throats and they're like bound together now. That's really all I know about this, and I'm more confused now than I was before I started it. I've only read the first chapter. I'm like 22 pages in, and the whole first chapter, it really, like, you're just in the head of this like 11-year-old, maybe. I don't know, it doesn't say how old they are, but I don't think they're like full-blown teenagers yet. You're just in her head and like her disjointed imagination, and nothing makes sense. And then this second chapter looks like it's almost like told in interview format with her mom, so I'm really not sure what's gonna be going on here. I am gonna go continue reading, and I will update you later tonight once I've made a little more headway into Oregon Meets, and maybe I'll be a little less confused. Stay tuned. Okay, everybody, let's do an end of day 6 wrap up for what I've read so far today. So we've already talked about A Devil Comes to Town. I have now read my short story For Never Whistle at Night, which this one was called Before I Go by Norris Black, and it was only like 9 pages, and this is like why I love anthologies, because I can read a 20 page one and be like, well, that was 3 stars because I wanted more out of it, but then I can read this 9 page one and be like, that was 5 stars and I loved it, and there's a reason I love it. That one was really about grief and kind of like what we would do for another chance to see people that we've loved and lost, and I really enjoyed that one. And then, like I said, I have started Oregon Meets. I'm actually following along on sprints. Katie is doing day 6 Summerween sprints with obviously Gabby and with Amy. I did just like go in the chat at one point, like in the midst of a sprint, and was like, I hope to God somebody answers me. I was like, has anybody read this, and like, am I supposed to be this fucking confused?
Confused. And Allie from Allie Dewey's Read was like, yeah, I read it and I like couldn't, it makes no sense and I couldn't tell you a single thing, but it's like, it was 4 stars. The thing is like, at first I was like, I understand that this whole book, we are blending reality and imagination together. But then I was like, is it just like also going over my head or is it supposed to be like this? Because there is some commentary on, you know, back in the day and kind of as how women were treated as dogs. So now there are these women-faced dogs and basically dogs with women's faces. Let me read the synopsis so I can know what I can tell you and not tell you. Okay, the girls learn that they have been preceded by generations of dog-headed women and women-headed dogs whose bloodlines bind them together. And also, well, let me keep reading. Okay, so the first few sentences of the synopsis also say that they have the ability to communicate with dogs. And the one chapter where I was like, what? Like, in the holy hell? The chapter is literally titled Rainy Rears Against Red Thread and Unwillingly Attends a Q&A with the Strays. And it's literally formatted like a Q&A, question and answer, but then the dog's answers, it's just like pages of text. There's no paragraph breaks, there's nothing. And like two sentences will make sense together and then it's just like immediately jumping to other things. So I was like, what in the holy hell? There's a lot of like, we're walking in dreams. It's very surreal. I'm very interested in where it's gonna go. I'm assuming there is gonna be some overall coming of age, like womanhood aspect to it. I'm enjoying it, but out of the 104 pages I have read, I've probably spent at least like 30 to 40 of them utterly confused and baffled. Maybe less than that. Definitely that one chapter and definitely the first chapter. And then some of the other stuff is just like so normal and so easy to follow. And then we get just these really surrealist chapters that I'm like, what? Like, what are we doing? And what is the end game here? What is it? I need to know. Can you tell me? I'm getting to the point where I want to skim and I'm not a skimmer. I don't like it. So I think I'm going to be done reading for the night. That and it's like 12:30 in the morning and I got up early. We went out to breakfast, but maybe I'll still hang out for the last 32 minutes of this sprint and do something else. I reached the end of that chapter. I got myself a drink. Simply Lemonade has spiked drinks and they're pretty good in case you're wondering. I think I'm going to go watch some Summer Mean vlogs and go to bed and hopefully finish this in the morning. And then I have no idea what I'm gonna do because I'm off all day tomorrow. I'm gonna get up tomorrow morning. I'm gonna finish this. This is taking me longer to read. And I'm like, I wonder if the audiobook is on. I don't know if you can hear that, but some Fast and the Furious shit is going on outside. It's a lot of cars. I wonder who's winning. I feel like they're far enough away that you can't hear, but I can hear. So we're just gonna see where the cookie crumbles tomorrow. And I am signing off for the evening. I hope you all have been having a fantastic Summerween. I say that every time. I hope you're having a spooky time, a fun time. I hope you're having a hot ghoul summer. Okay, I'm just gonna keep gabbing away. So good night, sleep tight. Classic Olivia thing where I didn't say all the things I wanted to say. Well, one, I keep thinking about this book, so I've realized some other things that I think is maybe why like I'm struggling with it, because I can read a confusing book and have a great time, and I can read a confusing book and not, or like a surreal book and not be as confused. So I think part of this is, for me, one, like, it's just the dialogue is not ever broken up out of the pages. When they're talking, it's just in the middle of the text and it's italicized. And that's it. So there's also just like nothing breaking up the pages. So not only are you confusing my brain, but you are not giving my eyes a break. And I'm struggling with that. And the other thing is, I forgot to tell you my page count for the day. I don't know why it matters, but I kind of have this vision that editing Olivia has every day been putting a count on the bottom of the screen to let us know how past Olivia has been doing. Because I didn't think to keep track of it in the moment. Whatever. Today I read 226 pages. I don't know if I said, but I did end up rereading the prologue for A Devil Comes to Town, which I said last night I was not gonna do because I remembered it. I fucking didn't. Like, I remembered it vaguely, but not, I don't think I would have been confused, but I think I would have like missed some tie-ins at the end. So it was a good thing I did that. So I read 113 pages of that. Never Whistle at Night was 9, and this has been 104 pages. So if I did my math correctly, that is 226 pages for the day. The Street Racers are back. Look, all I'm saying is I've seen every single Fast and the Furious movie, and the fact that they don't know that about me and I wasn't invited, I'm having FOMO. Okay? Just saying. Just saying. Okay, now we're gonna go to bed for the night. Good night. Happy day 7 of Summerween. Okay, let's talk books. One, just so quickly, I read my Never Whistle at Night story. It was 9 pages long, so really not that long at all. And it was called Night in the Chrysalis by Tiffany Morris. That one I'm just gonna give 3.5 stars, maybe. It was a ghost story. I honestly think that I might reread it because I read it immediately after finishing Oregon Meets, and my mind just... not fully paying attention, not fully there anymore at the moment. So maybe it will get reread, but not right now. Okay. Oregon Meets by Kaming Chang. I think I'm gonna give this 3.5 stars. Yeah, I think I'm gonna do it. Did I understand fully a lot of it? No. Did I understand the overlying themes? Yes, we're talking a lot about the different values placed on men over women or boys over girls. We're talking about what it's like growing up, feeling different as a queer woman. There's so much like that, and there is a lot of really fun body horror in this. And once we reached the point where it was 10 years in the future and we weren't following 9-year-olds, I understood more. Still everything, no, but there was a lot less like disjointed text of like being in the imagination of a 9-year-old, which while I didn't completely understand everything that was happening, I really enjoyed because I was the little kid who would hear a story and I would run around in my backyard by myself, like play acting it out. Like I get that. I get the imagination aspect. It was just, like, I just like, there's so much of this book where I'm like, what the fuck did I read? What did I read? The thing is like, I don't think I can give this more than a 3.5 because in 2 weeks, I'm gonna be like, I remember like nothing about that book. Like I can't, like what? What is it? I don't understand. And the thing is, it is what? It is now 3:08 and it is the final day of Summerween. And I think that this just like broke me. I don't think I'm gonna read anymore today. So this is a wrap on the reading, which means my page count for the day is 169 pages. So overall weekly page count will be down here for you. So let's do a quick recap on what I read. Middle of the Night by Riley Sager. I originally gave this 3 stars and now I'm like, is it like a 2.75? Like, is it? Because the first 217 pages were boring as fuck. Like, the main character was just talking in circles and I was like, babes, you've said that like 7 times now at this point. Can we move on? Can we please move on? That and like nothing shocked me. There was really nothing that shocked me. There was one thing and I was like, oh yeah, like I see what you did with the foreshadowing there, but nothing else was shocking at all. So this might be a 2.75. actually, which that's crazy. Sorry, Riley. Then I read Fantastic Land by Mike Bakovin, and what a turnaround, because this was 5 stars. I'm still thinking about this. I'm totally obsessed with this. This was great, and this, in opposite effect of Oregon Meets, I think I'm gonna be thinking about what I read in here for a really, really long time. A Devil Comes to Town. Did I give this 3 stars or 3.5? I don't remember. I think it's getting 3. Like, I don't think this did anything overall that's really gonna stick out in my mind in the future. I really loved the concept. I just wish it was executed a bit differently. And then we have a 3.5, and then we have a whole bunch of mixed ratings from the 7 stories that I read in here. That being said, this short story collection is going extremely well. So these are all of the things that I read for Summerween. I hope you all had an amazing reading week. I hope you had some more higher ratings than what I had, but I hope you had nothing lower than what I had either. Overall, I'm not really bummed out about anything on here. I mean, do I wish that this was better and there was more fun twists? Yes, absolutely. This, I checked off a new release. This, I was supposed to read a month ago for a book club. This, I have been obsessed with the concept and it's been sitting on my shelves, and I enjoy a delve into weird fiction. This is the first weird fiction that I've read that I'm like, wasn't fully for me. You know, usually the weird fiction, it's up there, it's a 4 or a 5, and this has just been a great time. So the reading has actually gone pretty well this week. Next year, I think I want to try to do like 2-day vlogs at a time and have a theme. Like Gavin this year, he had one where he only read at night, but I kind of want to do that next year. But like, what if I stay up for the whole night? Like, I'm gonna have to request time off of work if I want to execute that. But like, what if I just completely fuck up my schedule next year and stay up the entire night and see what I can read? And I can just read like a bunch of short horror. That would be really fun. So like, me already planning next summerween. Thanks, Gabby. But actually, like, sincerely, thanks, Gabby. Like, this is such a fun readathon to participate in. I am usually always on vacation. This is usually always the week that we are on vacation, so I never actually fully participate, and I usually just do one, like, read one thing that goes along with a prompt because I don't want to have the FOMO. And I love Halloween, so why not have Summerween as well? But thank you all so much for watching. And like I said, I hope you have had an amazing Summerween. I think I'm gonna spend the rest of my day working on editing this video so it doesn't go up like a full week after Summerween. Like, if I could get it out tomorrow before work, fantastic. Thank you all so much for watching, and I will see you soon with another video. Bye!